Well, hello again, old friends. If you are a Grateful Dead fan, you might look up Lenny Duncan. They wrote a beautiful blog post, a Substack article about Phil Lesh and the impact that he had on Lenny. Lenny is, they are my mentor. Keeping your prayers all those who are experiencing losses like that. A special thank you to Holy Trinity Lutheran Church out of Upper Arlington over here with a massive crew this morning, a ton of kiddos, and quite a few guests from Germany. And so it was pretty neat to see them jumping in. I showed Gretchen a picture of the president of my last congregation, and I said, I'm freaking out because he looks exactly like Bob. And the president said, yes, I mean, that is, so I'm sad that I didn't get to connect with him a little bit more. Our Bible studies on Tuesdays are paused, but we still have our Sunday morning Bible study here. Keep Sister Dean in prayer. She is still dealing with shingles and the pain that comes from that. So keep in your prayers for recovery and healing, please. Impacting community series. I keep saying this tonight, but it's actually this afternoon, 4:30. We'll have Carly Booz from the Housing Authority, Affordable Housing Alliance, here to talk about issues in our community surrounding housing. Hope you all can make it. It's in partnership with Urban Connections and our dear friend Kathy Alexander. So I hope you can be here for that event. We'll be given opportunities to put what we learned into action. So hope to see you there. Reminder, we've got Narcan if you need to pick some up. Any updates on the Warming Center at Riverland Field or on the Yale Ministry?
Definitely for the first. I'm not sure about the 15th. Definitely for December the first. We're on target for
at least the time for the
15th. Yeah.
I think that's for the office or for getting prepped and all that, getting everything in.
I think that's what that's for.
Yeah.
And the dinner so far is on schedule.
When will that start?
November. This one.
Very first Thursday in November.
Very first Thursday in November.
Excellent. So for those of you watching later on, or if you couldn't hear Winfield, the Warming Center is opening up on December 1st. They'll move in on the 15th, but the service won't start until December 1st, and then we'll have Thursday evening dinner starting up again. Those are from 5:30 to 6:30 downstairs on Thursday nights. That starts on the first Thursday of November. Reminder that, and thank you for everything you're going to help get us there, all of you. John, did you guys have a work day today? Did anybody show up for the work day?
Yeah, it was me and Jason.
Thank you, Jason. Thank you, Jason. Thank you, John. If you are interested in supporting the hurricane relief in Hurricane Milton and Helene, I think I've only got Helene on here, Lutheran Disaster Response is a great place to give. Of course, there are others, but we know if we give there and specify hurricane recovery, every penny goes to that recovery effort. And now, congrats to Gretchen on opening a brand new emergency room on Tuesday. And other exciting stuff happening. Oh, she's also a grandma again. Oswald, but you can call him Ozzy. Or Waldo. Congratulations. Tuesday was a big day for Gretchen. Congratulations. You're still standing. good call.
Fall back on Saturday night so that you arrive on time on Sunday. That's it. It'll be in the email, and I will resend that on Saturday. Okay.
Thank you, James. All right, Gretchen.
All right, just want to make sure that everybody knows, you know, Pastor's been with us for about a year and a half now, and we haven't actually made it official with the Synod. So that's what we're going to do 2 weeks from today. We'll have a congregational meeting right after church, and we will do the official thing of calling Pastor to be our pastor. Right now, he's rostered with the Synod again in Southern Oregon.
In Oregon.
And so now he'll become part of the Synod here once we have this one. So we hope that you can join us. This is an in-person sort of thing. It's in 2 weeks, Sunday, November the 10th, right after church. So it's an in-person sort of thing, although I believe we are going to try to add Zoom. I know we have some members that are not able to join us in person, so I think we'll be able to put a Zoom option on there as well. So if you have any questions, please feel free to come talk, but I hope you can attend, and we'll see you there.
Thank you, Gretchen. And now we'll prepare. Oh.
Can you mention this evening?
Yes.
The Embankments. Yeah. Embankment Communities. Thank you. Let's prepare our hearts for worship. Now let's lean into that amazing grace, trusting that God hears us, sees us, and loves us with a grace that is unstoppable. A grace that is so amazing we can't describe it, but a grace that is so true that we do experience it. Let's rise as we confess the reality that we need that grace, that we need that amazing love from our God. Blessed be the Holy Trinity. One God who forgives all our sin and whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Let us confess our sin and come to God for healing. Let's pray. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have honored you with our lips, but have harmed our neighbors with our tongues. The cravings at war within us cause conflicts and disputes. In our desire to be first, we make distinctions among ourselves. We place the needs of the poor and the suffering last. In your great mercy, forgive us our sins. Draw near to us with grace in time of need, and turn us to follow the way of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God promises to forgive our iniquity and to remember our sin no more. By God's amazing grace, you have been saved. And in the name of Jesus Christ, the source of eternal healing, your sins are forgiven. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Many sternly ordered him to be quiet. But he cried out even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and said, "Call him here." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up. He is calling you." So throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said to him, "My teacher, let me see him." Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." Immediately, he regained his sight and followed him on the way. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace to you all in the name of Jesus, our Savior, Jesus, the one who loves us beyond measure, who heals us, and who leads us on the way. Amen. I see at least a couple of you came ready for Reformation Sunday, or maybe you're just Ohio State fans, it is Reformation Sunday, but we do this funny thing in the church where, you know, we have this reading cycle called the lectionary, and we go through three different years of this cycle. You can choose to have a regular Sunday this Sunday or a Reformation Sunday this Sunday, and we chose to kind of do a mix of those things. So it's still green up here because we're using the regular readings, but we're playing a mighty fortress and amazing grace. We're all great Lutheran. Well, at least two of the great Lutheran, yes. We'll see what James comes up with after the sermon.
Amen.
But it is Reformation which reminds us that we are always and ever reforming. That's who we are as Lutheran Christians. That's kind of the identity that we have. First and foremost, grace. But second of all, always changing. Always adapting. Always knowing that God is up to something new in our lives. And I think that we see that actually in this reading today that's just supposed to be the normal boring Sunday. This Bartimaeus, Simaeus, Simon, he's the son of Timaeus. He's a blind beggar. He is about as on the margins as one could be. I mean, he's got all sorts of strikes against him, all sorts of things working against him. He's number one, a beggar, so that tells you how society views him. We know from just the neighborhood that we're in that our society does not value those who do not have enough. We see it every day. Things have not changed, have they? So, number one, he's an outcast just based on his economic abilities. But number two, he's blind, which means that in that day and age, he probably had no way to make money. Like, that may be why he was poor. But also, in many ways, the religious people of the day thought that blindness was often a sign of disfavor, displeasure from God. In fact, there were rules about who could enter into worship, and that never really hit home for me because I really don't know blind people, but I remember so clearly, he's now a bishop, but at the time, Pastor Craig Satterley, he's now a bishop up here in the Midwest somewhere. He is a pastor who is blind, and he came and spoke to a retreat that I was on, and we were actually reading a scripture that would indicate that he might not belong because of the problem with his eyesight. So physical problems, it didn't matter what they were. Some of them were seen as worse than others. And so, I mean, that's why That's why there were laws about, if a woman was on her period, that she couldn't be near men or whatever. Like, all of these things. There were stigmas and rules around how we treated people who had problems. And as Pastor now Bishop Saturday preached, he was talking about how I wish I could remember which passage it was, but he's blind. He's blind, and the communion table is much closer, but he's preaching like this. And he talked about how beautiful of a gift it was that even in this passage that he talked about, that now even I am welcome on the table. And I still to this day get chills thinking about that moment of seeing a blind man acknowledge that Scripture had been used to harm him, and yet Scripture helped him find his way into grace and understanding and love, and even into the fullness of serving God in many different capacities. But the reality is that if Pastor Saturday was not blind because of God's judgment, the same is true for this guy, Bartimaeus. But they didn't see it. And then we really know that he's an outcast and not accepted and on the outskirts, and the society is pushed him aside because his name, Bartimaeus, Bar being son of the defiled, son of the unclean. That was his name. His name pointed out the reality that he was absolutely on the outside. He's even on the outside of the city of Jericho. And the road between Jericho and Jerusalem was not very pleasant and was filled with all sorts of danger. And he's right there on that edge. And he calls out to Jesus and says, "Son of David, have mercy on me." This man who was and is at this moment blind can already see who Jesus is, more clearly even than his disciples at this point. You'll remember, or you can go back and look, but from the time of the first healing that happened a little bit earlier in Mark for a blind man until now, all sorts of people were not able to see what God was doing. Multiple times, the disciples or others were not able to see the heart of who Jesus was or what he was doing, and yet Bartimaeus cries out, "Son of David, have mercy on me," and in that moment puts all of them in danger at the same time, foreshadowing what's happening the week following. Let me catch you up. This was a political statement. "Son of David, have mercy on me." He is naming Jesus as a ruler. He is naming Jesus as one who has authority. He is naming Jesus in the midst of the Roman occupation that at the time when Mark was writing it, a revolt was happening or had just happened, and Rome had smashed it down. This was a political threat to the powers that be, and that's why the people told him to be quiet. "You're going to get us all killed. Be quiet, you're going to get us all killed." Not that we don't think Jesus is pretty stellar. I mean, we don't necessarily know what's going on there, but we do know enough to know that they're afraid that that word is going to get out and going to put them in even more danger. But Jesus is fully aware of that, and the Holy Spirit seems to be fully aware of that too, because about Jesus' disciples and a large crowd that could have looked like a fledgling army walked into Jerusalem on what we call Palm Sunday. That's a week after this reading. On Palm Sunday. And what do they yell out? Hosanna. Son of David. And that too was a political moment that Jesus himself enacted. He went in, kind of reminiscent of a Hebrew scripture story, he went in on a donkey instead of on a chariot. He went in with a bunch of lackeys instead of a powerful army. He went in with the people supporting and not having to just throw all his power around. He went in and found the danger that the people were afraid of. Called it on himself, and ultimately we see where it got him. Because this is not just a story about a miraculous healing where a man received his sight again. It is a story about outsiders being the ones who can show us who the way is and how he is working through us. It is the people who have it the worst who can point us most genuinely and most authentically to the one who provides for all. He's the one who can take a person like Bartimaeus, who is shamed by the rest of the community, and not only have him stand up and regain his sight, but tell him to go on his way, and instead this man knows and follows Jesus on the way. In Bartimaeus, we see a man who is no longer sitting and begging beside the road, but is walking along the way, offering the divine. We see in Bartimaeus someone who is so far gone that his name indicates that he is unclean, that he is a scourge on the face of this planet, that he is worthless. Even his name says that, but Jesus calls him to stand up, and he, in return, follows Jesus on the way. When we look at Jesus and throw off everything we have and give everything we are to naming the reality that he is our Messiah, we find that he brings us along on these journeys that are meaningful, that are often incredibly difficult, but on journeys where we see the real path ahead of us. Bartimaeus again knew this. I forgot to kind of fill you in on that. When he is told that Jesus is calling him, he throws off his cloak, which many people believe is probably the only thing he owned. Compare that to John and James last week. Jesus said, "What do you want us to do for you?" They said, "Give us more power. Give us more." When Jesus calls him over, he gives away the last of his clothing and runs straight to Jesus. And what does he ask for? When Jesus asks the same thing, "What would you want me to do for you?" "My teacher." That's a humble address. "My teacher, let me see again." Such a humble thing. Such a simple thing, but something that will change his life. Not just because of the manifestation of the faith that he must have had in order to receive that sight, but then can you imagine what it's like to really know what the way forward looks like? We are in a time now where we don't know what the way forward looks like. We really don't. When we listen to people like Michael Wilkos and others, or maybe even Carly Blues tonight, we hear about how hopeless things are in Columbus in particular because of the housing crisis, the housing shortage, and the projections are it's only going to get worse. We don't know a way forward also because our country is in a great period of distress. Is it 10 days from now we go to the polls? Unless you've already voted like me. 10 days from now, the shape of our country is going to change one way or another. And even if we get really clear results, things are going to be ugly. If you're paying attention, you know this is going to be true. You know if one candidate wins, we're going to be facing a whole lot of trouble, even more so for the people in our communities. Right here in Columbus, not only impoverished people, but LGBTQIA people, immigrants. It's going to be awful. And we're going to need to stand up and be a voice of reason. We're going to need to stand up and be people who put ourselves in harm's way to care for those who are targeted. If it goes that way, we've got a scary 4 years ahead of us. But the reality is, if the other person wins, we're still going to have a genocide happening that we are paying for. If the other side wins, not only will that continue, but most of the policies that need to be changed are not going to change. That's how it is in this two-party system. So we're still going to have to be putting our lives, ourselves, on the line to care for those we, as a congregation, have been called to care for. And it's going to be even more important that we have our ears and eyes and lips about us, because the reality is that we're doing that kind of work in the name of Jesus underneath an administration that we, you know isn't going to change a lot. We're still going to be dealing with, unless it's a real blowout, but I think even then, all of the lies that we've heard over the last 4 years multiplied exponentially about the election loss, which is going to cause a lot of distress in our communities, which is going to cause a lot of these people, in my estimation, and from the people I know who study and know this stuff, that it's going to be an actual physically dangerous time in some places. I would hope not here in Columbus, but you never know. The first Sunday I was here, we had literal Nazis down next to a land grant brewery. Like literally, the first Sunday I was here, Nazis on our streets. And not just, I'm calling them because they disagree with me, like literal swastikas. Friends, we may not be like Bartimaeus, but we can. We may want to sit here and beg for the scraps of normalcy and for our lives to remain normal and calm and sweet and easy. But I believe we've had our eyes opened to a new way, and that's why we're already here in this sanctuary together. Because we have been so moved that once we've received that gift of being able to perceive better the realities of the kingdom of God and how we as a society are falling short of what Jesus wants to see us enjoying, we can't help but get up and go on that road to walk on the way with Jesus. To be people who live into the name that was given to the first followers of Jesus, the way. Jesus, who is our way, our truth, and our life. Jesus, who is the one who conquered death, rose from the grave, and offered to us eternal life. That same Jesus has called us to open up our eyes to see the realities on the ground, but also to see what God sees, and that is a hope for a future filled with people like Bartimaeus, who recognized at one point that at least society thought he was trash. Hopefully he never thought that himself, but it would be hard to not believe that. But if you believe you are trash, if you believe you are too far gone, if you believe that you might as well take on the name of Timaeus because you're so gross and worthless, then hear Jesus call yet again. Stand up. Your faith has healed you. Go on your way. And if you do go on your way, you can follow along with the rest of us who are striving not only to see like Jesus, but to be like Jesus. Amen. Now we will turn to God. Now we'll turn to God in prayer, trusting in that faithfulness that God hears us and responds. I'll say, God of grace, after each of prayer, you can respond, hear our prayer. Challenged by God's word in Christ, let us pray for the church, the world, and the whole creation. Eternal counselor, guide the church along your paths of mercy. Direct us all to be a refuge where all are genuinely welcomed and where all gifts are celebrated. God of grace, hear our prayer. Eternal nurturer, preserve natural places for rest and rejuvenation. Guide the work of conservationists, park managers, urban planners, gardeners, and all caretakers of natural spaces. Attune us to the wonders we disregard or fail to notice. God of grace. Eternal wisdom, strengthen the voices of those who cry out for change in unjust systems. Give lawmakers, judges, and all those who occupy seats of power, listening and compassionate hearts. And may they turn their eyes towards the needs of the most vulnerable. We pray also for our country as we head to the polls now and in the coming 10 days. We pray that you would give us all wisdom, from the smaller issues to the national choices we are making. Give us wisdom. And may you work through whoever is elected. God of grace, hear our prayer. Eternal compassion, train us to respond to the cries of those in any kind of need. Give encouragement and comfort to those who call out for relief from pain, grief, or oppression. We pray today especially for all of those at the Friends of the Homeless shelter. We pray for Sister Dee, who's still recovering from shingles. And we pray for Pastor Carol Lee and Brother Fred Grace as they are in nursing home type facilities. God of grace, hear our prayer. Eternal servant, grant vision and wisdom to the church so that those who are in need are not ignored. May the command of Jesus to love our neighbor sharpen our focus for work in your kingdom. God of grace, hear our prayer. For what else do the people of God pray? God of grace, God of grace. May we hold fast the promise that we will be together with all of our departed loved ones in your presence forever. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
In your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in the saving grace you freely give, both now and forever. Amen. Before we move into the piece, I forgot one announcement that I wanted to share. Gretchen's joy overshadowed my joy in the midst of a little bit of a tough week last week. My sweet, I might have moved it on you. Oh, no, there it is. Meet Jenny. This is our new puppy. She is 90 pounds. She is big. And I don't have enough time to talk about her, but her and her sister Coda are getting along very well.
She has a brindle.
And what?
She has a brindle.
Brindle? Is she what?
Brindle.
I have no idea.
She looks like a brindle.
Yeah. She was at the Columbus Humane Society. I highly recommend going up there if you're even thinking about getting an animal. There are so many in their tiny little cages. So, maybe we live up there while the kids come back. See my new friend? That's my new friend, Jenny.
Beautiful.
The peace of the Lord be with you all. Let's go.
baptized. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and our praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy. Whose blood can cleanse.
Go in peace, follow Jesus on the way.